Hi everyone, welcome to After Dark Analysis. Today I want to talk about how Hard Candy is essentially a modern retelling of Little Red Riding Hood. Now, before we get started on this one, I want to make it clear. While the Brothers Grimm rendition is probably one of the more extreme childhood tales we hear, it was cleaned up quite a bit, and the original iteration had a lot more to it. Little Red Riding Hood was not always pursued by a wolf. Sometimes it was a vampire, an ogre, a werewolf. But for our purposes today, we'll stick with the big bad wolf because that's probably what most of us know. In some iterations, the wolf actually leaves the grandmother's blood and meat for Little Red Riding Hood to eat. So she unwittingly cannibalizes her own grandmother. And in many versions, she is asked to remove her clothes and get into bed with her quote-unquote grandmother, which we, the reader, know is the big bad wolf. Sometimes even asking her to burn her clothing before she gets into bed, which takes things to a whole new weird, creepy level, which probably explains why it was cut out in a lot of the versions we were told. In most of the iterations where she gets into bed with him, it ends there. But there's another telling where, while she's in bed, tells her grandmother that she needs to use the bathroom specifically for number two and doesn't want to do it in bed, which is perfectly reasonable. The wolf isn't so big about his dinner running off, because she's realized at this point it's the big bad wolf and not her grandmother. So he says she can go out, but he has to tie a piece of string around her so she won't get too far away. She ends up slipping the string off and running away, which is a smart thing to do. We're talking about fairy tales here. I get our suspension of disbeliefs a little off. And even other iterations, because there are a lot of them, she pushes the big bad wolf into the fire while he's cooking the meat he got from her grandmother. So a little Hansel and Gretel twist there to avenge her grandmother. But the thing all of these different variations have had in common so far is there's no huntsman. There is no one coming in and rescuing Little Red Riding Hood. Her perishing or escaping is completely on her. The first time we actually see any kind of presence show up to help Little Red Riding Hood, it's a laundress. She sees the girls in duress, pulls a sheet nice and tight across the river. So Little Red Riding Hood runs over it. When the big bad wolf comes after her, she pulls it up to catch him in the sheet so he'll drown in the river. I guess the assumption there is Little Red Riding Hood would weigh less than a wolf. And the reason I want to focus on the versions of this tale where no one comes to save her is because this is really what Hard Candy plays off with the character of Haley. And no, it's not a, she don't need no man to come in and save her. No, it's, she patched this plan. She has to see it through. If she dies, that's on her. If she lives, that's on her. Because while yes, a laundress or huntsman coming by and helping out would be nice, in real life, we can't always believe that somebody's gonna come by and do the right thing. A lot of times, anything we do is our own choice and our own decision, and we have to follow through. This 2005 film starts on an online conversation. It's very, very flirty, somewhat sexual. What we assume is the guy keeps saying tease. What we assume is the girl keeps going on about how it's totally doable like her. JK. JK though. It's cringe. It is. It really is. But this is a adolescent girl flirting with a man who is much older than her. And it's supposed to be awkward because that's what it is. We open up on an online conversation between two people that we later identify as Haley and Jeff. They meet up at a coffee shop called Nighthawks. Haley is 14. She is in the 8th grade and reading Romeo and Juliet during the summer to get a jump start on 9th grade reading. In the dialogue, it's revealed that Jeff and her have an 18-year age gap, so quick math deduces that Jeff is 32. The conversation between them is kind of awkward and oddly flirtatious, but both of them seem very aware that this isn't something that they should be doing and it would be rather frowned upon. There's a point where Haley even mentions that she is auditing med school classes that her father teaches, when Jeff jokes about guys in class hitting on her, she's like, yeah, they wouldn't hit on a 14-year-old girl. They're old enough to be my dad, which she immediately backpedals from when she realized Jeff is mildly offended. And at one point, Jeff even says, well, I'm going to have to wait 4 years for you. The intent's clear. There's no skirting around it. Haley buys them food. Jeff buys her a shirt, but demands she model it for him because Jeff's a photographer, so it's totally not weird. He also entices her back to his place with the promise of a bootleg from the Gold Rap concert, which Haley is lamenting she was too young to go to. One thing that is very important to note here and will come back later on in the film, from the online conversation, Haley did set up the meeting. She picked the place and seemed to kind of push for it, but Jeff was in no way, shape, or form resisting. Online and in person, he constantly refers to her as a tease, or she's teasing him. And at one point, when she's changing out of her top that she was wearing into the shirt he bought her, he called her a little girl. She opens up the bathroom door to reveal herself in a skirt and a bra that she kept on. Eventually, Haley relents and goes back to his place. Her reasons for doing which is they've been seen together at Nighthawks. So if she goes missing, people will have some kind of record of who she was with. It's Goldfrapp, because just it's Goldfrapp apparently in Haley's world. Jeff had joked prior that Haley going back to his place would be insane. And Haley states that 4 out of 5 doctors say that she is insane, so she has to do it to be true to herself. And fourth, once they get to his car, his amazing car is why she totally has to go back there. It's also important to note that while Jeff suggests she call her parents to tell them where she is, she does not call her parents or her older sister who dropped her off at the cafe. Once back at his place, he pours them both glasses of water. She rejects the water, saying they teach us the young things to not drink anything we haven't poured ourselves, in favor of going to the kitchen herself and finding vodka to mix up a couple of screwdrivers. During their little drinking session and tour of his home, Haley keeps kind of razzing him about keeping up with her on the drinking. The topic inevitably turns to sex. She points out that he has pictures of models all over his house, girls that he shot, because his home is also his studio. And she points out it's kind of weird that these models are staring at him in his most intimate moments. He swears he's never slept with one of the models because most of them are underaged. She points out most of them are pretty scantily dressed. He's well aware of the legal boundaries and how far he can go or not go. But he does eventually confess to sleeping with one named Janelle. Apparently, she signed a Ford very soon after the shoot and became kind of a big deal, implying she left Jeff behind. Haley starts trying to coax Jeff into doing a photo shoot with her. Instead of going to his studio proper, she insists on doing the photo shoot out in his living room while she's jumping on a couch, playing music in the background, and taking her shirt off, again exposing her bra. During this, Jeff gets more and more disoriented. We're assuming that's some kind of effect of the alcohol, because he's down at least 2 screwdrivers in the span of what in movie time probably isn't more than half an hour. He attempts to give her direction. She doesn't listen. He eventually snaps at her before passing out. While Haley originally donned a bright red hoodie and bright red leggings at the cafe, she has ditched those pretty much as soon as she gets to Jeff's house. This is important because when Jeff comes to, Haley has restrained him to a rolling office chair and has put something over his head. It is very obvious that she is now in control and there's something much more going on here than a 14-year-old meeting an older man from the internet. She gives him some water while admitting that she had swiped a vial from her dad and didn't know how much to dose in his drink because she really couldn't ask her father and she wasn't sure if the alcohol made her clumsy and put too much in. Jeff asks, why do I get tied up first if this is how we're going to play? She responds with, playtime is over. This isn't funny. Is this some teenage joke? Haley responds back with, teenage yes, joke no. He understandably begins to scream and she starts to spray his mouth out with some kind of cleaning solution. She points out that the neighbors to the one side of him are on vacation and the neighbors to the other side of him artwork, so no one would hear him. She had been following his user account for months online with a myriad of different profiles. What she figured out with the profile she actually got him with is anytime she said she was older than 14, he'd immediately stop talking to them. Every time she brought up an interest, he was all of a sudden very knowledgeable about it, but it took him a few minutes. He had figured out he used the exact same descriptors for Goldfrapp as an Amazon review. He excuses the other accounts by saying those girls were boring. He just wanted to impress her. That's why he went and lied about his interest. Because most people have done something stupid or misleading about themselves to win the affections of somebody else. It's typical. At this point, Haley is donning his suit jacket and glasses, and she has been tearing apart his house while he's been passed out, specifically looking for anything that could be incriminating. He gives the standard "I'm a good guy" speech, "Go ask the models, they'll tell you," which she immediately comes back to with, "Yes, of course, those girls are your work, you're not going to piss where you live." On the other hand, seducing girls online seems to be a hobby of his. This hunt leads her to a treasure trove of most people's most embarrassing secrets, his computer. She realizes his download manager says he has downloaded some images off the internet, but she can't find them. This convinces her that there is a hiding spot somewhere, because this is a guy who lives completely alone and has no pornography anywhere whatsoever. As her search intensifies, Jeff gets visibly more and more nervous. Eventually, she stumbles across a kind of art piece, almost, that's just filled with stones. Once she realizes she can move the stones, she finds a lock safe underneath of it. He believes she has limited time because eventually her parents are going to start worrying about her, and starts to try and manipulate her, talking about how they must fawn all over her older sister and not give her any attention for her to be doing something this extreme. She plays along a little bit, especially when he accuses her of having daddy issues. The only thing is, all he knows is what she has told him, meaning most of the data he has about her is probably completely incorrect. Cutting to her trying every single number combination she can think of, and most of it belonging to Janelle, about her birthday, this day, that day, eventually connecting the dots of Jeff's screen name was Lensman 319. She tries the date March 19th and was able to figure out the year was 1989, which was the first time that Jeff and Janelle were together. While the viewer never sees what's in the safe, Hilly comments, "This is what they make those federal laws for, Jeff. This is officially sick." The one image we do see from the safe is a picture of Donna Maurer. Donna Maurer is a person that went missing from that area. We actually see a missing girl flyer behind Jeff and Haley as they're in Nighthawks. The picture she finds of Donna is of her fully clothed outside of Nighthawks. Sick of this, Jeff kicks Haley rather hard and takes her down. He's able to wheel himself back to the bedroom where apparently he's had a gun hidden. Haley eventually comes to and is able to get him to pass out again by choking him with cling wrap around his face. And it's also important to note here that Haley, from this point on in the movie, has a massive red cut on the right side of her head from where Jeff kicked her. When Jeff comes to, he is restrained. This next bit I'm going to get into, I'm going to try to do so in not very graphic detail. When he is restrained to the kitchen table, Haley is icing a very specific part of him and starts to talk about how it is the easiest surgery. And if farm boys can do it to cattle, she can too. She is going to perform a castration on Jeff. She's not going to take the whole thing, just a very important component of it. Jeff begins to bargain and tries to level with her in any which way he can. He offers her money, cameras, anything she wants not to do this. He even offers up a story from his childhood where he was caught in a compromising position with a younger relative and his pants down. So his aunt, catching them, set him up on the stove with the burner on and his pants down. She sets up a camera and starts in so Jeff can see what's happening. Once this procedure is done, She threatens to throw the remainder outside into the yard, but is worried an animal might catch it, because earlier in the film, Jeff had tried to explain what a nice guy he was, because he does nature and conservation photos. So if, you know, he's a great conservationist, she wouldn't want a squirrel or something eating it and getting sick. So she opts to flush him down the garbage disposal because there's no fixing it. She even relates this to a woodshop professor cutting his thumb off and having it reattached. But she wants to make sure the product is destroyed, so that is in no way, shape, or form a possibility. She then starts to give him water and try and walk him through the recovery process, support groups, and how to get help for this, questioning, obviously, why she's being so nice to him. Says, well, you're kind of pathetic now, and you're going to have to hide this. You're going to have to hide. You can't go to the hospital. You're going to have to remove your stitches yourself. You're going to eventually have to explain this to your doctor. And then you don't think he's going to tell his golfing buddies, and then they tell their friends. So she's talking about all of the things Jeff won't ever be able to do again because of the embarrassment, and how word's going to get around. She then walks off to take a shower, in which Jeff is able to get free. When he is able to sit up and look down, Haley had placed a clip to block blood flow, and it iced so heavy that he couldn't feel anything. She never did anything. Everything's still there. She never actually operated. She just wanted him to think she did. The camera footage that he was watching was actually from a castration procedure, which you find when he ejects the tape out of the VCR. Obviously furious and terrified, runs to try and get Haley in the shower. She's not in there. The shower's running though. And she takes him down with a stun gun. While he's out, she starts running around, cleaning up the house, trying to get everything back in order, of course while wearing gloves. To stay insanely casual about all this, she even calls a friend of hers saying, hey, I'm going to be done earlier than I thought I would. You want to catch a movie? You can argue for a possible alibi. She writes a fake suicide note that states, try to shoot myself, can't even do that right, and then calls Janelle, posing as Officer Haley, won't give her any details, but asks for her to come by the house. Jeff comes back to with a noose around his neck. Haley offers him a deal. If he commits suicide and hangs himself, she will destroy all of the evidence that Donna was ever there or he did anything wrong. If she has to forcibly kill him, she's going to make sure everything is out wide open, plain sight. Justification for this is, even if they have a suspicion this wasn't a suicide, no one's going to look for the killer of a pedophile very hard. During this exchange, a neighbor from about three doors down comes over to deliver some Girl Scout cookies. Unfortunately, Haley doesn't have money, so she has to run back in and pull it off Jeff while trying to keep him gagged. There is a line of questioning and exchange between the two, and it's obvious she doesn't buy Haley's lies. But at the same time, she doesn't have any proof to really go in there and do anything. She says Jeff's sick of food poisoning and that she's his niece. When she gets back in, he immediately picks up on that. He's like, there's no way she bought this. She is quick to point out that when Jeff did get free, he didn't call 911 and he didn't run for help. An innocent person would have done those things instead of trying to go exact revenge immediately. It's clear he knows he did something wrong. He once again breaks free from Haley by kicking forward, choking her with his legs. He's strangling himself in the process, but is able to swing back over quickly enough before he suffocates. She runs out the back door while he uses a knife to cut his hands free. While she's in hiding, he runs around the property looking for her, eventually going on a massive monologue about how Haley is just like her, and all of them are driving him crazy. He then turns to one of his photographs and stabs the model in the crotch repeatedly. Cause, you know, subtlety. He runs out again looking and finds Haley's bracelet conveniently at the bottom of the ladder leading up to the roof, where she had been at one point in the film during her search. Haley admits she left the bracelet there cause she was sick of waiting for him. A standoff ensues. Jeff still has the knife. Haley has his gun. This is when Haley reveals that Janelle's on her way. points to a noose now suspended from the roof, saying the deal's still on. You could either hang yourself and I destroy everything, or you can be found. And specifically, Janelle's gonna find it. Not only that, but she has concocted a scenario where she's going to start taking off her clothes and run into Janelle's arms and act as a victim of Jeff, which she believes Janelle is. Again, Jeff threatens to find her, and again, it's pointed out, he doesn't know her name, he doesn't know where she's from, he doesn't know if her father actually teaches at college or not. While all this is going on, Janelle does pull up and start walking around the house, yelling for Jeff, while Haley is on the roof whispering to Jeff's ear how they treat pedophiles in prison. And spoiler warning, it's not great. In one last ditch effort to survive, Jeff says his partner Aaron did it. And this is the first mention we've ever gotten of Aaron. Haley immediately comes back with, funny, Aaron said the same thing right before he hung himself. So it is now 100% confirmed beyond a shadow of a doubt, Jeff had something to do with the murder of Donna Maurer. And apparently so did Aaron. And it's clear that Haley, whoever she is out to destroy anybody that had anything to do with the disappearance of Donna Maurer. Jeff decides to hang himself while Haley is repeating the bargain. The issue is, the second he is down and she knows he's gone, she says, or not. She has no intention and never did have any intention of destroying anything. All of the evidence is still completely out there, and Janelle will find it, along with Jeff's hanging body. There is a suspension of disbelief here due to the height difference and all of that, but we're gonna leave that alone considering how flawed the source material obviously is. Haley puts her red hoodie back on and escapes through the woods. Now there is the obvious allegory for red hoodie escaping through the woods, little girl, big bad wolf, or in this instance, the big bad wolf is a big bad predator. Again, this version completely relies on Little Red Riding Hood's ability to be self-sustaining and fight back, because again, there isn't necessarily going to be a huntsman to save her. Not to mention the heavy-handed sexual innuendo that is in the original pre-Brothers Grimm tale. Many interpret the fairy tale of Little Red Riding Hood to be about puberty, because it's essentially about a girl who leaves home, enters a completely different state and situation she's not familiar with, and on the other side of that, becomes a self-sustaining person or an adult. And in many tellings, she ends up in the wolf's belly and either pushes her own way out or the huntsman cuts it open, which is some really heavy-handed symbolism about rebirth, which essentially is what we all go through with puberty. We have a body that we know and are comfortable with to some extent that changes, and we become a different person after. This rebirth motif also applies to how naive she was. She was naive enough to believe the big bad wolf was her grandmother. Had Haley not been the person she was with the background she did, she probably would have fallen victim to Jeff. You can argue she's concocted this revenge plot either because she was a friend of Donna or knew Donna, or you can argue something happened to her that caused her to go after anybody that did this. While it certainly doesn't take a traumatic event for many people to want to go kill a pedophile, for somebody to go to that length and that extent typically implies something traumatic did happen to trigger this change in personality. A 14-year-old, assuming she was actually 14, just going around spending all this time tracking down a bunch of adults, seducing them to kill them, that's a lot of time, work, and effort. And that's a lot of manipulation, a lot of lies, and a lot of moving parts to keep track of. It is not something people within the realm of normalcy do. Because the big factor in all of this has always been the Red Hood and its symbolizing blood. You can argue that is blood from menstruation. You can argue that is blood from losing your virginity, which most women do bleed some on their first experience, or the blood and everything else that comes with birth in a much more literal sense. But at the end, that red becomes vengeance. Little Red Riding Hood avenging her grandmother in the iterations where she does survive, and Haley surviving Jeff's attempts at getting away, and her avenging, we assume, Donna's death. This fairy tale in specific has a massive scholarly divide on a couple different parts of it. Some believe this is a tale of rape and coercion, and some believe this is a tale of liberation. And it can kind of work both ways, even in the context of hard candy. There is an attempt at coercion, and there is an attempt at rape, at least in the statutory sense, of Jeff with Haley. Once that script is flipped, though, it becomes coercion and manipulation from Haley to Jeff. She is in control for the most part of the situation. So even when she doesn't have her bright red hoodie and leggings on, she has a deep gash on her head that's the very dark, dried blood. There is some representation of red with Haley throughout almost the entire film. The liberation comes in either from her destroying whoever hurt and destroyed Donna, and from that sense of rebirth of coming out as a different person, because murder is no small act. It's going to change somebody. And as far as we can tell, this is at least the second time she's committed it, if not more. She could have possibly been doing this for a long time, since Haley is portrayed by Ellen Page, who isn't known for being a very developed actress. While she was a bit young when she played this role, her build lends to her playing a lot younger for a lot longer than most actresses could. So you could very easily make the argument she just has a body type that lends to her looking younger, and she uses that to go and catfish these guys, acting as her own laundress or huntsman. So what do you think? Is this the first time you've heard the original, not Brothers Grimm version of Little Red Riding Hood? Have you heard it before? Did you hear it in childhood? If so, what did you think back then? Let me know in the comments below. As always, if you like what you're seeing, please hit like, comment, subscribe. And if you don't like what you're seeing, please leave a comment and let me know. Thank you.